an RCD size 22 by 34. We'll go through layers, some of our line weights. Again, these are back in the first 6 chapters. Remember, there was that line weight area, I think it was chapter 4. You do want to look at pages 43 through 46 as title block information and what needs to go in your title block. I want you all to design your own title block in here. You might currently grab some of these old plan sets and pull them out and see what kind of title blocks you like the look of and mimic them. Certainly, you've got my title block, which I gave you back in drafting 135. Remember that house that we did? Had the title block on the side. That's the one I use. Hey, that's my title block. You do not have my authorization to use it. You do not. You can edit it if you wish, but you can't use mine.
Is there like certain things you want on it, like the date, obviously, your name?
Pages 43 through 46. Okay. We give you all the components that you need.
That we need, okay.
Okay. We're going to use 3 types of textiles. We'll go over this tomorrow. We're going to use 1/8 inch for our general. We're going to use 3/16 for our intermediate titles, room titles generally. And we're going to use 1/4 inch for our drawing titles. Okay, so we'll have 3 different textiles. We will organize them as listed up here in the section above, where it's site plan, foundation, blah, blah, blah. They're actually ordered always in the order of construction. Okay, so first thing we do is we start ripping the site up. Next thing we do is the foundation, then the floors. Okay, so that's where your plans are ordered that way. You should keep a personal log. Okay. This is extensive. You're going to be 6 weeks drawing on this. Get in the habit of writing down where you end the day, what you need to do the next day. Or I'm working on the foundation, I got this far, I still need to add. Boom, 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 boom. I'll give you a checklist later, but you should do your own. Because you will not remember, because we'll do a foundation, then I got to jump over to the floor plan and do this, and then I got to jump back to here. You're going to be all over the place. You will not get it done unless you're organized. Now, you do not have to write it down on a piece of paper. A lot of drafters will just open Word in the morning and have it sitting in their taskbar, and every time they jump off a plan, they'll just pop open Word and type themselves a couple quick notes. Or I think there's even a little post-it thing you can download off the internet that puts little yellow stickers on your screen. Okay. There's all kinds of different ways of doing this. There are professional ways, like the Franklin Organization System. Anybody heard of that one? You have? Okay. Missy, you have? Did it ever work for you? Mm-hmm. It worked for you? Worked for you? God, never worked for me. Okay. I finally got some advice and somebody said, hey, take the Franklin's part that you like and then take Williams over here and their part, and I blended them all together in my own part, and now I've got it to work for me. Okay. But come up with your own method. That's why I'm not going to preach one in here, because I think all of us are hybrids of all these. Okay. But stay organized. And a personal log does this. We will have deadlines in here. And I am going to hold on to these. I've been fairly lax on this. This is not a discipline where we can be lax. Just so you know, when I call a deadline out on a drawing, if you aren't going to meet it and you're late on it, you're going to get a 0. Okay, for that. That's just all there is to it. Okay, so I'm going to throw this out front. If the drawing is not in on time, I will still critique it for you so that you got the information coming back. But you're going to get a 0 in the grade book for that assignment. Okay? We have to meet deadlines. We are now in industry. We have crews waiting on us. We have clients waiting on us. We got bankers waiting on us. We have all of that. If we stumble and don't meet our deadlines, the project doesn't get off the ground. Okay. Any questions on that? Are we all clear? Okay. Your grading, all sheets 1 through 8 will be handed in individually as well as at the end. And the next 2 days will be announced through class. Now notice that the bottom part of that, when you hand in all the individual plans, that's going to be half of your working drawing grade. The packet at the end will not be one assignment. That's going to count also for half of your working drawing grade. And if you don't remember how that's set up, where we have the working part, and then you have your appearance part. It's all in our little grading sheet that we handed out at the start of the year. All right, so here's how it's going to get rolling. This will start today sometime. You're going to be provided with a letter from the client outlining their intent. So you're going to get some sketches. You're going to get a letter asking you to work on a project. It's going to come into your mailbox today. I don't know what time today. It depends on how much time I get. I will guarantee you it will be here before I leave, whether I stay here until 10 o'clock tonight. You probably don't want to stay with me, but it will be in your mailbox in the morning. Yes?
Are we each getting a distinct project, or are they all the same?
They're all the same, but when you meet with your initial client, if you, let me explain that in just a little bit, okay? Cheryl, let me kind of push you back on that, because it's coming down here on that. The short answer is you're all getting the same. They're all probably going to be a little different, okay? So you're going to get that. Now, I do want to change this. Okay, we're push this back a day. You're going to get your first meeting with your client. We're going to do it in a mass meeting. It's not going to be Friday at 8:15. That's tomorrow. We're going to do it on Monday. I want you to at least have one solid day to play with the client's wishes before we go into this meeting. Okay, and then you also got the weekend to think about. So Monday, 8:15. On this meeting, I am going to ask one thing. We don't record it. It's not going to go on there. This is up to you to take the notes. You're meeting with your client, so you need to get their information. To do that, you need to be good at note-taking. If you have areas you need to ask questions on, you need to come prepared for that. We'll talk more about this tomorrow. Because I'm a client. I'm prepared. I'm going to give you some base information. But here, you need to draw out more information. And we'll cover a lot of this tomorrow. Where can you get this information? A lot of people will hand out a questionnaire to every client they have. And then ask them, how many kids you got? Your ADA? What's your finances? Where you want to live? You got a view? You know, all these types of things. What's your lifestyle? Do you cook? Do you not cook? Do you entertain? Do you need a movie theater? What do you need? A lot of people will do that. Yes.
So will you tell us exactly, like, I'm going to sit down with you today and talk to you, or is it just...
We're going to do it as a class meeting. I'm going to be the client up here. I'm going to take on some other shoes. I'm going to change things a little bit from what I give you. Just so you know, the floor plan I'm going to give you is not perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And there will be some things that change.
Okay.
But there will be some other things you need to know also. That I will have in the background, and I'm not going to give it up unless you ask me the question for it. Okay. Right here, prepare a list of questions. Know what you need to know. Think about information that wasn't covered in your letter. What type of materials? What type of style of building? Okay. Is it going to be a craftsman? Could be a tutor? Needs versus wants, a huge one. What do you really need, and what do you want? Comes back to your pocketbook a lot there, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see. You should have enough information to begin work on a floor plan. That's the first drawing we will do. We'll outline the drawing, because we can't move any further until we get our exterior and interior walls defined. We can't really go anywhere. So that's what we'll start with. Again, this is why I don't want to record it, and I want you to take good notes. This is one of the worst things ever. A client doesn't appreciate being perpetually pestered by an incompetent person. Okay, in essence, when we come through a meeting and we say, hey, I want you to take this mud room and I want you to add a washer and dryer for it. We'd say that in a meeting. And then 3 hours later, you call the client and say, you know, where's this washer and dryer going to go? That's a quick way to lose a job, right there. Just on that one comment. Stay focused. Get the information you need. Write it down. Don't trust your memory. I think, you know, like these, you see me leave these all over. As I get older and older, my memory gets worse and worse. Maybe your folks are the same way, or your grandparents, or whatever the case. It doesn't matter. Don't trust your memory. I've been leaving car keys and stuff since I was 16. Your memory always skips that stuff. Don't trust it. Write it down. Ask your client to repeat it if you didn't hear it or get it. Are you writing something down and they moved on to a different topic? Could you please pause for a moment? Let me make sure I got this documented and then let's address that. That's not rude. That's not bad etiquette. That's good etiquette. It means you're competent. I want this information. I need it. Okay, so in essence, section two, it's where we're going to go to here in a little bit. So the overall project, you receive a letter from the client. That's going to happen today. Design a response with a typed reply. You'll see that in the letter. You need to recontact the client. I'll talk more about that tomorrow. Three, the client responds with an email to arrange a place and time. I will do that. That will happen on Monday at 8:15. But it's going to be documented through correspondence. Number four, the big meeting takes place, information exchange, until such a time as the client's comfortable and the designer has determined all pertinent criteria. Okay, that should happen on Monday. Now, a future meeting time will not be set here. That's going to be handled individually. But it will happen that week. So next week. Five, the designer generates a floor plan according to the client's specs, which it must be done by the next meeting day. Again, that's going to happen next week. Now, these meetings take probably 45 minutes to go through. There's 13 of you. You can kind of imagine that kind of means we get 5-6 of you a day. So if you wait till Thursday afternoon to set up your client with your meeting with your client, you're probably not going to get it. These meeting times will be first come, first serve. Number six, floor plans approved or not. May not be, getting this too high. Or not. If it doesn't get approved, then we will set another meeting. Okay. And you will make the changes necessary to get the thing approved. In essence, when you come into that meeting, if you say, hey, I got this really trick idea, but it doesn't come with the client's thought pattern. Remember, I mentioned this yesterday. Client probably is not interested in your dream home. They're interested in their dream home. Okay. So try and put yourself in their shoes designed for them. Let's go to section two. How are you going to put this preliminary floor plan together? Just because it's preliminary here, it will probably be undimensioned. I'll give you some examples of this tomorrow. Just because it's preliminary doesn't mean that this thing's sloppy. Remember, you're still interviewing for a job. Your client has solicited 13 freelance drafters, so he's gonna pick one. You're trying to get a job. You're bidding the job here. So make sure it is clean, but you don't wanna do so much work that you're losing your shorts over it. Now this happens to every single company out there. How does a firm get a job like this building? There were six people that were solicited, six architectural firms to do this building. They all came in and gave a bid package where they did so much work on it and said, we will do this and this, and they drew. This thing was drawn by six different firms and nobody was paid a dime. Five of those four firms went home without making any money. They lost money. One made money. They're the ones that got hired. That's just necessary in the consulting business. All consultants go through this process. We just hired an architect out of the Filer School District. I was on their planning committee for that. We brought in seven people for that. And it cost them all some money. We ended up hiring one. Six of those people went home and lost money. They lost their travel. They lost all the hours they put in to do preliminary drawings and studies of the area. And that's just all stuff they know is part of business. And I'm guessing that they probably had, you know, anywhere from $5,000 to $10,000 invested in the bid process to get the job. And they lost it. And, you know, that's just business.
So are you going to pick one
Oh, snap. Here we go. Are we making money or not?
I'm not going to answer that.
Okay.
I'll plead the fifth on that.
Okay.
All right.
I have the right to remain silent.
If you want to do your preliminary floor plans, in today's world, I haven't had these two chosen in quite a while, but yeah, it's totally acceptable to do freehand. Okay, if you want, if you're great at sketching, you can do line weights. You can do great work doing this. Go for it. That is done. Mechanical. Okay, so get one of them big D sheets. We got a whole bunch of them in the back. Set up on a drafting table and do it there. Okay, that's acceptable too. I haven't had either of these two used by any students for a decade. Everybody has gone to this route. Be that as may, you can do whatever you wish. But I would really, people seem to go to the computer thinking that if I do these others, I'm wasting my time. I'll tell you what, as you develop this floor plan you're gonna get, and I'll tell you, talk about this tomorrow, you're probably sketching quite a bit before you ever go to here anyway. Okay. But be that as it may, it does take time to do a mechanical drawing, and then eventually you gotta go to CAD, so you're gonna be re-digitizing it in there. But be that as it may, you can do it anyway. It's tough to beat the computer for a nice, clean, orthographic view, which that's what you do on a floor plan. Section 2.2, we're gonna talk quite a bit about space and layout considerations. You might make a note here, chapter 10 is your best reference on this. Because you just got to know some things. You know, I'll just come right down. I mentioned 9 and 10. 9 doesn't have much of it. 10 has most of it. For example, hallways must be a minimum of 36 inches wide. And that's a fire code thing. Now, if you want a house to feel airy and not like a dungeon, the best way to make a house feel like a dungeon is put a long hallway in there that's 36 inches wide. And people will stand on one end of it, and it's kind of like those old... I just suddenly went blank. What's that old movie show that where they went into space-time and reality?
I know what you're talking about.
You know what I'm talking
about?
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. Start the show where a guy's looking down a hallway and it just looks like a black thing. Anyway, that's what it looks like.
Yeah.
If you got a hallway that's 25 feet and it's 3 feet wide the whole way, people expect all the pictures to get knocked off the walls, things like that. 42-inch hallway is much better. You want to try and keep them short. You know, you just got things you want to do. But got code, if you build that hallway 35 and a half inches, it's getting red tacked. One of those walls is going to move. That's just all there is to it. Because you can't get a wheelchair down. It's just code. You got to have an access from everywhere 36 inches wide to an exterior door that's 36 inches wide. Okay, we just got to know that. A lot of these are in here. There's another place in here. Your materials, like a washer and dryer, standard size for them is 30 inches. That's their width. Their depth is standard 24. Okay, so if we're gonna put those in a hallway, you've all seen washers and dryers where you have little bifold doors that open into a hallway. It's a great way to utilize space. But what are you gonna put in there? You don't want 63 inches because now you got an inch and a half on both sides of those things, and what are they full of? They're full of old socks and things. You can't reach back there and get them. You just want to make things fit. Closets, what size do we do closets? They're 24 inches interior. And all this stuff is kind of listed in these chapters. That will help you size the plan. I gave you a kind of a quick punch list here at the end. Now, at this first part, just keep in mind, you aren't going to work this out to the nearest sub-inch as you come into your initial meeting. It will be somewhat loose. You'll fine-tune it later. But here's some things to think about. Doors and windows. Doors and wall openings. You cannot put them right in a corner. They have to be 3 inches out of a corner. So if I have a wall, what I mean by that is if you have a wall that makes a turn like this, okay, I cannot put a door that swings open right here where that's the edge of it. Okay. Now, you can do anything you want, but this is not gonna really fly. What you want is when you put that door in, okay, it's gonna go here, or this distance right here is 3 inches. Now that's needed for the structural part of the door, but it's the best use of the space of the door because you want it to open against the wall. Okay, you don't want it to open all the way because now we've just wasted another 3 feet of floor space here. And we mentioned yesterday, floor space is typically around $130 a square foot. Now you've just taken, what, 3 by 3, that's 9 square feet. By having that sitting out here where it's opening up and I can't use that space, that costs you $1,000. But we want to utilize that space. Try and put them in corners whenever possible. It's the best utilization of that space. Now there's other considerations. Certainly if we need it centered in a wall for a look, like a front entry door, we do that. But what I'm talking here is bedroom doors, these types of things. Stairways have to be 3 foot wide, prefer 3'6" or 42 inches, especially if you're going to be moving anything big down these things, like a bed or furniture, okay? Clear space, where walls where a bathtub is situated. You know those shower bath combos you buy out at Home Depot that are plastic? Does pretty much everybody have one of those in their house? I bet most of you do have at least one in there, even if you've got a trick home where it's all custom. Well, they're all built at 60 inches. So our framing for it is 60 inches because they'll slide in there as that unit. All your countertops are typically 24 inches out from the wall. You want to see that? The best I had them do custom cabinets in here because we had big sheets to do, but the cabinets that sit with the coffee pot and the tea thing on it and the sink, that's a real standard cabinet. Okay, so if you wanted to go ahead and measure those sizes and how they work. The uppers are pretty standard in there also, where those are typically 12 inches off and there's that little area in between on the height.
That can vary where the client wants, right? The height and
You can vary it, but you're bringing the cost up substantially.
We're just moving the counter down or a cabinet down or up. It's a difference.
Yeah, because now you're going to a custom home builder instead of buying stuff off the shelf. So you might be hiring Black Pine Cabinets to do that.
Right, you can buy stuff off the shelf though and put it wherever you want it.
No, you can't. Well, the uppers, they just screw to the wall. You can put those about wherever. But the bases don't. They come in boxes.
They don't have adjustable legs?
No. The stands that they go on are custom. You can buy the standard ones off of Home. I can do a kitchen at a Home Depot for $5,000 that's got cabinets all the way around it. All mid-level stuff. Remember, this kind of, I'll give you that information tomorrow. If I go to Black Pine, I can easily spend $25,000 on that same kitchen for doing custom cabinets. I bring the cost up 500-600%. Just depends on what your client's willing to do. Kitchens can run you a lot of money in a hurry. Without a doubt, it's your most expensive room in the house. For now, stick with your standard sizes. Okay, that can all be discussed with your client. Make use of appliance literature for sizes. What size is the stove? What size is the fridge? Certainly we'll get into that. Assume for the preliminary drawings that the appliance is 30 by 30. That's most of them. Okay. Ranges are pretty much always 30 by 30. Fridges, they can vary now in today's world, but most of them are 30 by 30. Closets are 24 inch deep, that's inside. Okay, that's not the outside. Let me just draw you a quick one. If you do have a closet, we got a wall here, and I'm going to put a closet in here with a couple walls. Okay. And let's just put a door to it right here. Okay. The distance is 24 inches is this distance here. Okay. So when you do a closet, you've got to have 24 clear inside. But remember, we're going to put a rod in here and hang stuff. Right? And if you don't have that 24, all your hangers are going to be sitting sideways because you can't really hang them unless you have that. So figure that for your space. That's at a minimum. Certainly walk-in closets are different. Standard kitchen and bathroom layouts, one page 190 to 199, H. Building dimensions. Should be done to the nearest 2 feet. Most of your building materials will come in 4 foot increments. So we try and build to the nearest 4 feet because one big part of our job is to remove waste. A typical house has anywhere from 20 to 25% of waste, where half of a quarter of the materials brought on site are thrown in a dumpster and hauled off because the sizes had to be cut down. If you can minimize this at all, you've saved your client a boatload of money. In fact, I think with a properly drafted house, you should be able to get that waste down to 90% pretty easy. Or excuse me, 10% pretty easily the other way, if you plan correctly. Now, you will not get everything to the nearest 2 feet. There's gonna be times you gotta say, oh, well, this room's gotta be 8 foot 9 or something like that. It has to work that way. But try and get as much as you can. The thing is, if I do a house and somebody says, I want it to be 55 feet in this direction, I can build that exact same house for the same cost and do it at 56 feet. You can do it at the exact same cost. So why wouldn't you give them more space for their money? Okay. Or drop it down. Now the reason we say 2 feet is many times like OSB, plywood, drywall, we can cut half of those things off and use them on the other side. Okay. We have a big enough piece to use there. Okay. So try and go to the nearest 2 feet. With that said,